So good evening and welcome to one and all. I'm Sreshi, the assigned moderator from Clanet. Clanet is India's most trusted and widely used Digitech platform with multiple e-meeting services for doctors. Clanet is very proud to be a part as a digital partner for this event organized by Society of Onco-Anesthesia and Perioperative Care. And the topic of today's session is Leadership is Onco-Anesthesia and Palliative Care. So let's begin today's session, for which I would like to invite Dr. Soham Solanki sir to take over. So kindly proceed with the talk, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. And I welcome all to this 34th session of this SOPSI National Webinars. And today we have a very important topic of on this leadership or the mentoring in Onco-Anesthesia and perioperative care and palliative care. So for this, we have a very renowned madam, his mentor, his leader, and everything. So I invite Dr. Kalpana Balakrishnan, she's director at ADR Cancer Institute, Chennai. So I think she will guide us in for next 1 hour about the how we take a lead and in the Onco-Anesthesia and palliative care, and also we can how we can mentor. So Kalpana madam, please take over the session.
Yeah, good evening to all. Thank you, Dr. Solanki. Actually, the person who's going to do all the mentoring and speaking today will be Dr. Anjum Khan Jod. Dr. Anjum, I'll say a few words about Dr. Anjum. She's the Director of Anesthesiology, Pain and Palliative Care at Bhagwan Mahavir Cancer Hospital and Research Center. And she's had extensive training in palliative care and in anesthesia. After finishing anesthesia, she's gone on to do a few courses in palliative care like cancer pain management, graduate certificate course from Flinders University, Australia, leadership training. She has been a part of leadership training from San Diego Hospice and Ohio Health in Columbus, which is a part of the topic today. So we would be using all the knowledge and skill that she learned there. And in her day-to-day life, as she's the director of anesthesiology and pain and palliative care, we can hear more about the leadership skills that she uses in her day-to-day practice. She has multiple publications and multiple presentations to her credit. She's had multiple, she's been a part of some of the important part of palliative care, in the sense that she's been setting the standards for palliative care. In 2017, she was a member, and now in 2023, she's the convener for the standards of palliative care. She's also was part of the end-of-life care group. So over to Dr. Anjum to speak about the leadership skills in onco-anesthesia, perioperative care, and palliative care.
Thank you, Dr. Kalpana. Thank you, Dr. Sohan. I'll share screen and start with the slides. This is a difficult topic to do online, very close to my heart. And I think you will all agree with me, very important part of our skill set in addition to our clinical skills. I hope I can give you a brief taste of leadership skills and how we can work on them. I'm sharing screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Shesi. So I hope you all were able to see that small mini inventory I sent out. And I hope you have crossed out the answers in that. And there are only 10 small questions, which would probably take less than 2 minutes. I hope you had a chance to look at those questions, because that will be something that we are covering in today's session. So as Dr. Kalpana said, I work in anesthesia and palliative care in a cancer hospital. This is a small trust hospital in Jaipur. And I had the privilege of being exposed to a leadership course. And the topic we're talking on today is the 5 exemplary practices of leadership. I would urge you all to read this book by James Cousins and Barry Posner. This is the course that we went for. It was a 1-year program in San Diego and Ohio. And 39 of us from 25 countries. And these are the mentors. People working in palliative care will recognize Frank Ferris and Kathleen Foley, leaders. And Kathleen Foley used to be in Memorial Sloan Kettering, is one of the authors of the WHO Stepladder in Pain. First, why do we need this kind of session? Why does one need to be a leader? And as postgraduates, as MBBS students, we thought our clinical skills were enough. You need to be a good doctor, a good physician, a good clinician. You need to have good a history taker, somebody who can auscultate well and connect the dots. So why does one need to be why does one need leadership skills? As a part of this course, I actually understood that in Australia, even the final year medical students have to do a leadership course, because leadership is so important in your, like Dr. Kalpana said very appropriately, in your everyday life. So we know that the healthcare environment is increasingly getting more and more complex. We have very sick patients, sudden surprises, there's changes in practice, changes, every day is new evidence. We have to learn and unlearn and relearn. There are different opportunities for growth and research. We are also worried about our own physical health, our family's health, and our team health. The need for money, the need for being, of the need of meaning, the need of having a purpose, and being part of a family. So these are all why we need leadership. And we understand that in our roles as anesthesiologists or as palliative care physicians, we have a common goal: optimal care for the patient and optimal environment for the formal caregivers, the doctors, the nurses, the psychologists, and for the families, engaging and understanding the team, delivering effective teamwork, communicating in the team, and we're able, so that we're able to demonstrate a benefit, and we have continuous cycles of improvement. Now, most people assume that leadership is for somebody of Dr. Kalpana's stature. She's director of an institute or maybe a head of department. But I would like to debunk that myth. Everybody is a leader. So as Peter Drucker said, that unless you work at leadership and unless you work to deliver your goals, only three things happen naturally, and that is confusion, friction, and underperformance. So we really need to work. If you have a good leader and that gels with a good team, you perform better and you have better outcomes, not only in the clinical realm, but also in your own work-life balance. So a healthcare system that supports effective teamwork can improve the quality of patient care, enhance patient safety, reduce workload issues that can cause burnout among the healthcare professionals. So of course, a good leader and a good team will lead to a much better outcome. Now, many of us assume that you have to be a born leader. There are certain innate skills or traits because of which you lead well, you automatically assume that role. But that's not always true. Yes, some people have inborn traits which help them to assume this role early. But leadership can be learned, and it must be learned, I think, because the way we function today as teams, no one is really working in a silo, and no one can be effective in a silo in the kind of work we do. So leadership is a skill that must be learned. So the book I'm talking about is The Leadership Challenge. It's written by Barry Kuzis and Posner. It's been written after 30 years of collecting data. They actually analyze the leadership stories of people who have led in different industries, from the hotel industry to the hospital industry to IT, every industry. And they analyzed more than 5,000 leadership experiences and over 3 million survey respondents. And they took data from more than 72 countries. And after they published their book, there have been more than 500 research studies on these principles. And guess what they found? They found that ordinary people, people like you and me, guiding others' journeys, surprisingly had similar paths. So what Kuzis and Posner maintain is that when getting extraordinary things done in ordinary organizations, I'm not talking about big centers like Tata or Ames or Adyar, ordinary small, I work in a small trust hospital. So when getting extraordinary things done in ordinary organizations, leaders engage in the five practices of leadership. So these five practices are: model the way, inspire a shared vision, enable others to act, challenge the process, and encourage the heart. So in the next 28 minutes, we will go through each of these exemplary practices, and you will I'm sure you will say, oh yeah, of course, my teacher does that, of course my HOD does that. So you will identify these principles in practice. You may not have heard them being defined in so many words. So we're talking about, again, I like to emphasize, everyday leadership. I'm not talking about leadership like Gandhiji or Narendra Modi. I'm talking about everyday leadership. It's about the everyday simple acts we do in theater or in our OPDs, which make a difference to the lives of others. So model the way. So the first principle really is modeling the way. Clarify your values. If you are in a leadership role or intending to mentor, lead your department, your team, your group, in any context, it could be when you're organizing a conference, it could be when you're organizing a webinar, it could be when you're organizing an acute pain service. You need to clarify your values and find your voice. And it is very important for us to model to what Americans say, to walk the talk, not only expound a particular principle, but to live it. I don't know whether Dr. Jyotsna has logged in, but when we worked with Dr. Dasgupta in Jaslok Hospital many years ago as SRs, and what he actually believed in, he practiced. So whenever we had a patient, a biohazard patient, a hepatitis C or hepatitis B who was being operated, he never asked the residents to go into his theater. He said, these difficult cases I will take care of. I'm less likely to have a needle prick injury, and I will, you'll needn't come inside. I want the least number of people in my theater. So he was actually demonstrating amply the principle that he followed, that taking care of all of us. So we really need to practice what we preach, and not only give it a theoretical instruction to our team, because then that your team sees through you if it's only a theoretical instruction which you're not actually practicing. If I can ask if Sohan can tell me. Sohan, I mean, we, all of us have seen great leaders at work and have seen certain principles that if you get, oh, I would like to be like him, or if I wish I could practice that particular thing that she does so well. So that's the role model we really pick up. So, Sohan, would you like to add something to what role modeling could be, or a role model you have seen?
The role model, exactly, I don't know, but I can say like a few people in my life, like they really made some difference. Like I met so many, our teachers from my MBBS days to MD and all through my life. So, but two people I can definitely say they made a big impact on my life. One was Dr. YK Batra from PGI Chandigarh. So because his way of like working in the OT, and his really a good attitude toward research and making life easy for junior residents, senior residents, even junior consultants, all. So, and I really learned a lot from him about the research and the work, and how we can increase the he was very enthusiastic about turning over a fast turning over in the OT, how we can utilize our OT time better, and finishing all the cases of the list on the particular day. So that person had a great impact on my life. Apart from him, Dr. Divyatya, when I joined Tata, so he also have had a very big impact on my life. So because his attitude toward the patient, toward the any problem, which you can go with any problem with the whatever you have about the patient problem or your research problem or your some teaching problem or any personal problem also, he will listen and he will give you sound advice. And I think he's very good leader in he can influence many people, right from his colleagues to his juniors to all the junior most residents, all these things. So that's why the people really love to have great leaders like both of these I mentioned.
Thank you, Sohan. So very important points Dr. Sohan brought out from improving the workflow, from improving the comfort level of the junior most person on the team, from making time to listening to your team members' personal distress, to making the team more efficient, to making the younger colleagues more open to research. So you actually can pick up different parts of different role models and actually try to become like them, because everybody has different qualities that you can imbibe and become a better mentor or a leader. Thank you, Dr. Sohan. I also remember we had Dr. Bhatia. I trained in KM Hospital in Pune for a while, and Dr. Bhatia's basic day, every daily routine began at 7:30 a.m. He began his rounds in the ICU. All of us had to go to the ICU first to see how our patients had done in the previous night. So I see so many doctors being trained in anesthesia today who come to our hospital. And once the patients left the theater, they don't go back to see whether the pain was controlled, whether what was the intake output like, what is the lung like, are they breathing on oxygen? Because now they feel it's intensivist domain. So they're not really so concerned about what's happened in the theater. And Dr. Bhatia set those principles for us day one. We had a 7:30 round every day. Every day he took the ICU round with all of us. So it's what these teachers have demonstrated to us and what we can imbibe and what we need to demonstrate for us, for our team members to follow through. So people also often follow the person and then the plan. Modeling the way is about earning the right and respect to lead through direct involvement and action. So it's not only the position that gives you that right or gives you that the ease or the control or the command. It's the way you deal with your people, the way you deal with your team members, the way you teach or practice what you're preaching. So people, again, working in palliative care will recognize Dr. Rosalie Shaw, nurse, social nurse, volunteer, and doctor. She was one person who actually demonstrated everything she taught and did and had had huge influence. Like Sohan says, Jiggy has influence over so many residents. Rosalie has control over Southeast Asia, the whole of the Pacific, because the way she's been teaching and mentoring people, going to people's houses, teaching them, and making you part of their team. Dr. Kalpana, you want to say something?
I just want to say something, Anjum. See, yeah. Your notes are being displayed. Can you make that bigger?
Pardon?
Your presenter's notes are coming on the side.
Okay.
So that the presentation itself is smaller. So maybe you can...
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for telling me. Okay.
Yeah.
So what did I do wrong? I'll just stop share and try again. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's better. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Kalpana. Okay. So, like Sohan said, be the kind of leader you would follow. And he said, he explained exactly to us what reason he has been so impressed by the mentors he has worked with. And I would think that that's the kind of thing you would emulate and try to take forward to the next generation. So in order to become a leader, it's important that I first define my own values and my own principles. So I need to be clear exactly what I stand for and what my team, what my group, what my family at work understands by my principles at work, my values. And it can be difficult for you to understand in the daily, in the busy routines that we're following, in the terribly busy routines. Vibha is still at work. So that kind of routine is difficult for us to sit down and think. There's another book which most of you might have read in your earlier days. It's The 7 Effective Habits of Daily Living by Stephen Covey. And that helps you define who you are. I'm showing you a slightly weird slide. So I'm told that another thing that Stephen Covey says is that you can imagine yourself, imagine your funeral. Imagine that you have died and it's your first anniversary. What do you think your team will say about you? What do you think your people visiting the hospital or the people you worked with will say for you? And what is it that you want to be remembered for? Because that is what, like, I mean, I'm sure Dr. Batra is not there in this session, but Sohan remembers so fondly what Dr. Batra taught him. The teachers I'm speaking of are not there in this session, but I remember them 20 years, 25 years after I've qualified. So what is it that your team will remember you for? And what is it that you want? What is the legacy you want to leave behind? So, I mean, again, like Sohan said, taking care of the junior most person in your team. When I trained in anesthesia in Pune, the team philosophy was the junior most person ate first. So I was the junior resident and I was given the opportunity to have my lunch first, then the second year, then the third year, then the chief resident. And that's a policy we followed now in our hospital. The technician first, then the GR, the DND student, second year, third year, SR and consultant. So it's taking care of each member of your team in every way. In the COVID years also, there were, like I spoke about Dr. Dasgupta. Dr. Dasgupta took care that all bioazard patients, he would anesthetize himself. And during COVID, we had this, unfortunately, one of my colleagues had to undergo a renal transplant. And she obviously was on so many immunosuppressants. But all her colleagues made sure that she didn't have exposure to aerosol. Whenever there was a surgery being done under mask, or under there's a risk of aerosol exposure, her colleagues would step in and prevent her from being exposed to any kind of aerosol. So that's a team feeling that you would want to your members to emulate. So the first principle we said was model the way. The second principle, again, very, very important, is inspiring a shared vision. Because if it's a vision only of the health department, it's not going to fall through. The whole team has to buy into that vision. So imagining an exciting possibility, including others in your common vision, you need to appeal to common dreams and shared aspirations. So if, for example, your hospital decides to be an NABH hospital or an IRAS hospital, the whole team has to buy into that philosophy for it to work. I like Dr. Kalpana said, I was at Ohio for this training program. And if you see their vision statement and their mission statement, it really clearly underlines where the emphasis is. So their mission is to improve the health of those we serve. And their vision is where people want to work. So Ohio Health, their bottom line was where people want to work, where physicians want to practice. So they want to build an environment where people want to work, where physicians want to practice, and most importantly, where patients want to go when they need healthcare services. So with that kind of attitude, this was their logo: compassion, excellence, inclusion, and integrity. So together we are. As part of rotation, I was briefly at MD Anderson Cancer Center, and Mendelsohn there wrote a vision statement for MD Anderson. He says, "We shall be the premier cancer center in the world based on the excellence of our people." So excellence of our people, that's the bottom line. Our research-driven patient care and our science. I'm told that Dr. Mendelsohn, as the president of the facility, he toured the hospital with a yellow pad. I can imagine Dr. Kalpana doing that, asking employees what they needed to excel in their work, tracking patient experience the first phone call till the end of treatment. Innovations in care were both cultural and functional, and he reorganized care around the patient rather than the department. And all of us are familiar with his tagline, making cancer history, this inspirational MD Anderson tagline. So it's important for our whole team to have, even if you're organizing a conference, if the whole team is part of the, has an ownership of that conference, ownership of that acute pain service, then they deliver different kind of work. It's not a transactional leadership in which I order somebody do that. It's a transformation in leadership in which we are both together working towards a better acute pain service. I hope I'm able to get through the difference between a transactional leadership when I'm ordering someone and a transformational leadership in which both of us are part of the common goal. So we had the opportunity of working with Asia Pacific Hospice Network and Lian Collaborative to do an approach study. This is relevant also because many of the people in this audience today, I think Meenakshi and Dr. Kalpana, are part of Approach 2. And our vision then was to help our department get better at research. And we collaborated with APHN and Lian Collaborative, and we did 300 interviews with patients and their families to see their perspectives towards the end of life. And it was a very good experience because all of us, including my social worker, had a taste of how to do good research, how to take questionnaires, how to upload their data, and we could collaborate with APHN, and as a result of that, we had these multiple publications in the international journals. And the whole team learned, because all of us not only had publications, but we also learned the process of doing research. We also got tools from them on Hindi validated tools in common symptoms and domains in palliative care. So it is a win-win situation. So having a vision for your team, a vision for your department, if you're going into uncharted territory without any plans, without a strategic plan of where you want to go from 2002 to 2016, you're not going to go anywhere. Your whole routine will take care of only your theater, only your immediate problems. You won't progress. You won't have a path. You won't be able to develop. So we spoke about modeling the way. The second principle was inspiring a shared vision. The third principle is enabling others. So someone along the course of our lives has enabled us or empowered us to be better at what we do. So this is something we need to pay forward. Fostering collaboration by building trust, facilitating relationships, strengthening others. I know that the DNB and MD program today insists on, I mean, it's a mandatory requirement to have a paper, a poster. But since 2005, when our first DNB started, all our students had to go to the state conference with a poster or a paper. It was a win-win situation. They got confidence. They were able to speak at a conference. We had a poster. Our hospital got recognition as a research center. And we enabled them to speak. We enabled them to do small research. And it helped them to get more confidence. And it, in some of them, encouraged them to be researchers forever. So unless we are able to, we were enabled by somebody else, and unless we enable our teams are not going to progress. Dr. Kalpana, would you like to add something about enabling or empowering teams?
I think enabling, empowering, everything starts with the way we respond to them. How do we, so you start with the lowest rung person. How do you treat them? Before allowing anybody to be a part of that, you treat them with a lot of respect. Then you create a culture where you listen to them for the smallest thing that they come up with. If you listen to all our colleagues, whether they be technicians or whoever, often it is the technicians who come with, some jugaad, which amazingly works. So when you appreciate that, all of these things, help in getting a good team to speak about all these. And also this group which forms when once each of their work is appreciated, when you have clear goals for this team, you say that after so many years, I'm going to have so many publications, we are probably going to start some teaching program, we are probably going to have something, and if by some chance you work towards it and achieve it, it's a team effort. So that's a major, you feel so good. And when you celebrate these small successes as a team, I think it goes a long way in helping bonding and improving the relationship.
Thank you. Very, 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 very relevant points. Extremely important points. When I joined this hospital, Dr. Kalpana, one of our mentors, founder mentors, was Dr. P.B. Desai. And he told us that every 18 day, aim for one paper every 18 months. You write, you work in such a way that every 18 months you have to have a paper. So you are like making these goals, and very, very, your point was so appropriate. Your technician sometimes comes out with a jugaad, which can be life-saving. So each member of your team is important, and leadership is a relationship. So, and also you need to help your people succeed. It's not about you being the HOD, and so all the credit goes to you, and you are the first author, and the conference is a success because of you, or the all the team outcomes are success because it's a whole team. Like Dr. Kalpana said, it's a team effort, and the team effort has to be recognized for each success. And I think we need to actively work for each member to reach their full potential. You might have somebody who's very good at their work but are very introverted, or who might have somebody who's extremely sincere but has never been exposed to research before. So it's part of your role as a team member, as a mentor, as a teacher, to see whether you can help them if they want to, help them to be part of research, to be part of a publication, to be part of a different skill set. It's Sohan also said, being visible during difficult times, during uncertain times. Another of my colleagues had unfortunately was diagnosed with a lymphoma during COVID. And we took care that for 2 years, she didn't have any night duties. Because she wanted, after she came back to work after chemotherapy, the department took a call that she would not have to do night duties or emergency duties. To supporting each other during maternity leave, during sick leave, during any kind of family crisis, rallying around. So I think this is another book by John Maxwell, and very, very important principles he lays down. So what he says is leaders become great not because of their power, but because of their ability to empower others, making your team do well, because on your own you can't. And the team doing well is a bigger, is a exemplary principle of leadership. So it's important for us to, like we all learned during our residencies, you know, a GR, you have very little responsibility. In your first year of your second year, you start taking care of cases independently. And you know, gradually your accountability increases. And as your accountability increases, your competence, your confidence, and you become a working team member. So you need to give your delegate, you need to actually in a real sense delegate, just instruct, and you need to offer visible support for when the person is not able to deliver or has a crisis. So we said there were 5 principles. The first principle is model the way. The second principle was inspiring a shared vision that your whole team has ownership of, a shared vision. The third principle was enabling and empowering others, other members of your team. The fourth principle is challenging the process. Now, this is tricky. So you're doing something which you're not done before. You've always done something in a particular way and it's successful, it's safe, it's working. But a new method has been developed. A new method is being developed across the world. And you need to come out of your comfort zone and try to do it the new way. And all these leaders with their successful leadership stories challenged the process. They looked for opportunities, they seized the initiative and looked outwards for innovative ways to improve. So I think the one way we can do that is we need to go to other hospitals and see how they are doing things. I've had the good fortune of visiting and working with, in fact, soon after I qualified, immediately after my MD, I went to Tata and met Dr. Sushila Shah, took an appointment with her and spent 1 month in Tata with Dr. Brenda and Dr. In those days. Again, I went to MD Anderson, to other AIMS New Delhi, Amrita, Dr. S.G. Nair. So it's important for you to go to another setup where you're not a part of the treating team to see how they do things. There, the technician, the nursing staff, the anesthesiologist, the nurse have so many things that they do differently, and you can actually learn from that. So it's I honestly feel it should be mandatory for all of us to have every 2 years an exposure to some other hospital for us to bring back new ideas to our setup. So in the book, the authors talk of a hotel in which a very successful Moulin Rouge, a very successful Cordon Bleu hotel, where the chief chef sends out the sous chef to competitive restaurants and asks them to see what they're doing differently. Is the menu different? Is the plating different? Is the serving different? Is the ambience different? So that they can bring those ideas back to their own hotel. So this is something I think we are all doing. The problem is many, like our hospital, we don't have sabbaticals. So when you go out, you lose on the leave, you go on unpaid leave, and of course your days of leave. So you lose salary, but I think it's so much more worthwhile in the long run because you learn so much more that you can bring back. So this was MD Anderson. We got back this national early warnings chart from Cardiff. We need to question the status quo, question what's happening. You need to send everyone shopping for ideas. My senior psychologist, Dr. Aarti, went for the Bangalore ICC. And at the Bangalore ICC, she met a senior psychologist who was doing a different technique for children for undergoing radiotherapy. So till then, we were always, many of these children had 28 days of radiotherapy. And we did the regular PAC and the investigations and took an IV line. Sometimes we did ketamine, sometimes we did midazolam. And it was 28 days of difficult times for the patient and the family. And Aarti went to ICC Bangalore and she came back with this idea of desensitizing the child. So for after that, we introduced this idea to our radiotherapy consultants. And whenever a child was sent to us for PAC, we collaborate with Aarti. And Aarti and her team would take the child to the radiotherapy room, first show him on the computer what the Orfit mask was like, take him to the console, make him lie down there. And after two sessions of desensitization, they were able to give 30 fractions of RT for these children without any sedation, no IV line, no NBM, no apoptosis, no risk of ketamine cognitive deficit. So it is a win-win situation for everybody. No cost, no side effects. Of course, they had to spend 2 to 3 hours taking the parents into confidence, taking the child into confidence, and working on this desensitization therapy. International paper on how she's doing that with children. So it is such a worthwhile goal. She went to ICC and brought this back to us. So are we doing this? Are we going to SOAPSICON and bringing back things to our hospital, and are our teams accepting the new ideas? This is what we need to work for. Otherwise, what's the point of going for conferences and networking and learning from others? So we need, I think one of the things that we all need to be, if we are in this profession, is to be a lifelong learner, experiment, take risks, generating small wins and learning from that experience. I know that Vibha is with us. Vibha, you've been, I think you've challenged the process often. Do you want to say something?
Like you said, life's always learning. It's about learning new things, trying, experimenting with them, seeing whether they suit your situations. If they work well for you, they stay with us. If they don't, then we drop them. And I think having an open mind, overcoming the fear of learning new things, like when ultrasound came in, or like when we took up vascular access, it was entirely new. But kind of learning step by step, watching people do, talking to people who have experience in doing these things, I think all these things go a long way in helping you learn.
Thank you, Vibha. And it's frightening to come out of your comfort zone and to challenge yourself. But I think it's one of the things which makes if you are not reinventing yourself and adding new things to your department and your service, you might become redundant and you won't grow. So it's actually mandatory to be, even this, I found when I did the inventory myself, I found this the most difficult for me as a person. I found it most difficult to do a new thing. So I have to constantly work on it. So you want to say something else, Vibha?
No, I think that's all. I mean, we have to keep an open mind and look out for things that could suit you. You have to shed your fears. Sometimes your juniors could be better than you in certain techniques, and they could also be your teachers. You can watch them and learn from them and try and improvise in whatever way you can.
Can I say
absolutely
something?
Anjali? Yeah, ma'am, please.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that while it is maybe challenging, it's also very exciting to learn something new, isn't it? So that, and when you actually do something and you do it right and it works, it's a great feeling. So that's something that we can keep an anchor to and try to do new things.
Thank you. And like Dr. Vibha said, somebody else in your team might have learned that. Like, we have two people, Dr. Sachin in my team, Dr. Deepshika in my team. They've gone for different courses. They are in regional anesthesia, and they've achieved different heights in that. And I am nowhere in that race. So when you have a difficult problem, you ask them for help. So that helps them grow and helps the team, and you have a much better performance, much better outcome. So like you said, your junior will teach you, and you have to unlearn and relearn. So that's that we have to accept and we have to encourage. Thank you, Vibha. Thank you, Dr. Kalpana.
Thank you.
So Vibha said, different perspectives, different opinions, different people. And even Dr. Kalpana said, you have to ask everyone, because somebody might have a totally different take on what you assume there's only one way of thinking of. You always done it this way. Somebody who has a different mindset, a different exposure, a different context of work might bring a totally new light to that particular problem. Traditionally in palliative care, we've always been considered as a social department. We are doing work for people. We don't expect to be paid. Your salary comes from anesthesia. Your social obligation is palliative care. So we've been criticized by the present generation because we didn't make it a sustainable option. And we had the privilege of organizing the 29th International Conference of Palliative Care a couple of years back. And one of the members of mine, a new member in my anesthesia team, she said, ma'am, you have to have a session on how do you earn money in palliative care. And it was a surprise for me to think that a conference in which you only have research and drugs and pain and nurses and physical therapy and lymphedema, how can you have a session on How do you earn money? And it was a session which, in fact, we thought we should call it "Where is the money?" But so it was a very useful session, and we added the session only because Shomi said it's an important session to have, which had totally slipped the mind, the organizing, but didn't think of having a session like that. So it's important to ask everybody on your team, ask everyone, because everybody has a different way of thinking, and they might add a totally new thing to the table. And like this cartoon says, we actually need to listen to their opinion, not just tick the boxes that I've asked everybody. We actually need to listen to people with different ideas. It's not necessary that because you're the senior most or because you've been around long enough, then you have all the answers. So this is one of my favorite quotes from Emerson. In my walks, every man I meet is my superior in some way. And in that, I learn from him, from the ward boy. Your first exposure in a hospital, very often the ward boy teaches you a lot of things. So the fifth principle is what Dr. Kalpana spoke about, encouraging the heart, recognizing contributions, appreciating individual excellence, celebrating values and victories in public, not in the privacy of a room, maybe in the tumor board, maybe in the journal club, appreciating the team's effort, the team's commitment, creating a spirit of community. So it's also, I think, from the way we have grown in our department, having fun together, working together, and having time together where the goal is not only achieving patient outcome, helps the melding, the molding, the joining. So this is, we have a regular Golgappa party. This is our head of department surgery, all of us having Golgappas. It could be anything. We recently organized a street play to create awareness across Jaipur. So the writing of the script, the practice sessions, the rehearsals, it went for a month. We went to 7 centers, 7 tourist spots, 7 places in Jaipur, and we performed there. And we were able to make friends with the social worker, with the ward boy, with the technician, with every new member in the team because of the multiple practice sessions. So creating time for that personal involvement. And it has to be, of course, like again, this cartoon says, Bob, according to company policy, you're just about due for a compliment. It's the 10th of the month and you're due for a compliment. So it can't be that kind of scheduled compliment or scheduled thank you note. It has to be genuinely felt personally with personal involvement, a genuine thank you. So this is again a skit we did on World Hospice and Palliative Care Day, and we presented it to all the doctors in the hospital. So I'm finished. Last few slides. Not everyone can be a leader of historic proportions. However, we all can and should assume leadership roles in our regular activities more often than not. So we need to have a definition of role, clarity of who does what, define boundaries. Leadership is task dependent, with a task defined by the individual patient's situation. Who takes the call? Who is the leader? It doesn't have to be the senior most person. It could be leadership by position, but it also could be leadership by permission. If you see a problem and you choose to take the lead, your action enables others to act. So you are actually being a leader without necessarily having that head of department tag. So what level of influence do you exert? How will you increase your influence? These are all things that you need to think about. How can you increase your partnership, your team building? What are the skills and behaviors you need to develop to improve your leadership skills? So I would like you to go back to that inventory that I requested you to fill and see what you have ticked and how you have ticked that. It was a very transparent inventory. It was clear what was the right answer and what was the not so right answer. And I would like you all to take a look at that inventory to see how you all fared. The happiest people I know are always evaluating and improving themselves. The unhappy people are usually evaluating and judging others. So if you scored, you need to see which of the three are your highest scores. Of 4 and 5, and these are your strengths. So this is what you do well, whether you are modeling the way well or inspiring a shared vision or challenging the process, enabling others or encouraging the heart. And you need to see the three lowest scoring questions where you scored 1 and 2. And these are areas where you're weak. So where you need to put in more work, and we need to identify that practice and have insight and introspection into what I need to do to lead better. So that's it. These are the three books that I've referred to for this session. Welcome to your leadership journey.
Thank you, Dr. Anjum. That was
Thank
very,
you.
Very inspiring. Any questions? Anyone has any questions or some comments or some additions or something to talk about? I myself have one thing to say,
yeah.
Which would be, you know, when we talk about somebody to emulate, it need not be one, you know, it need not be one person in toto. What I'm trying to say is, you could take one point from a person which you think is very good, and there can be multiple other things that you actually don't appreciate about that person, but still that one point of being very meticulous, coming on time, and you know, being very meticulous in everything that they do, that's something that you can take from somebody. And somebody else, you take, you know, my own department had a couple of army people where there were two heads of departments who were totally different. Some of them who know my department before I became the HOD, they were so different. But then you can take the good points from each of them. And so it doesn't have to be one role model, is what I wanted to say. It can be multiple people with a little bit of nuances from each of them.
Absolutely, absolutely. So in fact, I don't know whether it is probably in my notes somewhere, I didn't say that. You can actually pick parts of different role models to make your own role model. So you might pick up, like you said, the meticulousness from somebody, the punctuality of somebody else, the research skills from somebody else, and the ability to learn, and then make up your, you know, pick up those things that you want to follow.
And it also works the reverse way, you know. Nobody is bad. So that's one way of including everyone and saying that I don't like this. This is what he does and I don't like it. Could be one reason, but then everyone, if you take them all along, I think it's a great way of going forward.
So I think Dr. Pooja has asked for the books, the Leadership Challenge.
Why don't you put it up again, that slide,
yeah.
So that
I'll
people
that.
Can, now maybe they can take a screenshot or something.
Yeah, I'll do that.
So Dr. Pradeep says, excellent talk, very inspiring.
Thank you.
Okay. One thing I want to say, in my hospital, like, we don't have any hierarchy, and actually I'm really fortunate to work in a hospital like where we don't follow any hierarchy. But we see that in India, in many hospitals, in many medical colleges, in many centers, there are strict hierarchy, and people always want to prove ourselves over other. How we can change this, or I think we can improve something to have a good leaders across country, and I don't know how we can do it.
So very important. So unfortunately, almost all our colleges have that philosophy of the senior most person calling the shots, and the junior person has to actually, there's a lot of, what should I say, very difficult for them to have their ideas expressed, and almost impossible for them to be implemented. But I think it's probably a change in mindset. And I know that some colleges, even in Rajasthan, now it's a rotational headship. So Vandana, thank you, Vandana. Vandana says we can give them these books. We can give the people who are so hierarchy driven, we can give them these books so that they can imbibe those principles. I think also that because now more and more departments have changed. You're HOD for 3 years, and then it's rotated to somebody else. So that kind of pattern of functioning might change the behavior, that I own this seat and I own this place, and whatever I say, only that will be done.
Yeah, that's a great way of that's a thought process, you know, which would really help, you know, changing the HODs over a period of time. Lot of institutions follow that, isn't it?
Yes. And I think also Sohan, maybe the newer generation is less fixed on hierarchy. I'm hoping that our generation and the generation after that will be less fixed on hierarchy. And if we are more open, and then we can encourage that idea to go forward, that everybody has a say.
Yeah.
Sujata has a question. Sujata, can we ask? Can we give Sujata the option to speak?
I'm not able to see any question.
She said,
"Go
may
ahead
I
and
ask?" Yes.
Yeah. Good evening, ma'am.
Hi.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, good evening, ma'am. Very nice presentation.
Thank you.
Many times when you are working with a team sort of thing, and when you really develop, have your role model and you become this thing, you develop a leadership and you really want to pass it to all your junior. Many a times there is a misunderstanding that a lot of work been allotted to us and this and that. How do you come across, how do you overcome with these problems? Because genuinely we want somebody to take the lead and somebody to do the work. And in smaller goals, they will develop the leadership qualities, right? But many of the times, it is not the recipient is not that open-minded to take it in a positive way.
I would ask Dr. Kalpana to add also to this. But I think, Dr. Sujata, what really works is that if you are, it might take time, especially when there's somebody new to the department and they do not know how things function. The other thing is whether it's transparency of the work distributed. And the third thing is if it's fairly distributed. So if everybody, for example, has an opportunity to go to a particular conference by turn, or if everybody has the opportunity to do, if, for example, you have one particular department or one particular service which is less appealing. Yeah. So say, for example, cardiac cath lab or whatever. Yeah. So if that work is distributed equally to everybody and not only one person gets a difficult task or the high-risk task, so that perception of being a work and incentive and disincentive, punishment and carrot being equitably distributed, probably and transparently distributed, probably in the long run, this solution could come. But Dr. Kalpana and Dr. Vibha, please add to this.
Yeah. I just wanted to chip in. So I just wanted to say that Dr. Sujata, maybe you think that this is whatever you are trying to ask the person to do is good for them and they should learn it, right? But that may not be their feeling. Maybe their interest is somewhere else. So I think knowing what the person is interested in, knowing where the person wants to grow, and guiding and mentoring the person accordingly, I think is more worthwhile. Sometimes we just get so fixated that I think this is what you need so that you can grow, but it may not actually be what the person likes or needs.
Yeah, exactly, ma'am. Leadership is not a one-day goal. Rather, it's a seedling sort of thing. And we need to work for many years. And then only you come into the inner circle, you come into the good faiths, you show your qualities. But to a certain extent, even we want someone else to work in a particular manner. It is good, whatever is good. As you said, definitely the person may not think I may not be advised by the so-and-so people. But then how, that's what my question was, how to communicate this transparency and how to minimize the misunderstanding of communication.
So to add to what Vibha and what Vandana are saying is that if it's do with a particular outcome, so then you have to have SOPs for that, because it can't be, if it is a particular intervention which has to be done in a particular, for example, aseptic precautions, or if you have an acute pain service goal of pain score of less than 3 or whatever. So that has to be very clearly mentioned, or very clearly your department goals have to be, they are not violatable if your pain score has to be less than 3 on leaving the recovery room or whatever. So that is not up to the person if she wants to do it or not. But like I think Vibha is saying is if she want to add, you want her to add to her skill set and she's not keen on moving in that area, then you have to maybe multiple conversations or discussion on what.
Or just respect that decision of that person not to go in for this. You know, you cannot force somebody to go in for just because it's cancer hospital to go in for chronic pain. There are a couple of people who are extremely interested. There are others who are not, who are happy doing only anesthesia. So let them be, you know, is what I would think. We also need to nurture each one's interest.
Exactly.
May I ask a question, Dr. Anjum? Yeah, I'm always intrigued by the leaders and how they manage. You mentioned that treating everyone equally. So I just wanted to ask, see, each person is different. So would treating everyone equally meet everyone's needs or requirements? Or how do you,
So rather than equally, equitably? I mean, I don't know whether, I think also one of the, in the inspiring a shared vision, I forgot my notes. So in inspiring a shared vision, I wanted to say that, like Dr. Jyotsna and the ENCORE and the European Society and Sohan and the SOAPSI and the eye infused trial. So it was involving a whole, I mean, they could have, Jyotsna ma'am could have very well have participated in the trial on, all by herself. The Tatas could have, all the Homi Babas could have done the trials on their own. But they took everybody together, and it's much more difficult to take everybody together. And forming SOAPSI itself must be a difficult task. So inspiring everybody for a shared vision, it's more difficult. If you have six people, it's much more easy to get an outcome. Having 60 is impossible to get an outcome. So giving everybody an opportunity to participate, and depending on their ability to participate, I think, did I convey anything?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think the first sentence said it all, that it need not be equally, but it needs to be equitably, because everyone's requirement is different, and you need to be able to tend to those requirements.
And you know, like what Sujata was saying, we have a corporate hospital next door. It's a multi-specialty hospital. They had these four gastroenterologists who are very good, very, very competitive. And you know how corporates often are tend to pit you against each other. So it's very, very competitive. So nobody was taking leave, and everybody was counting the number of patients, number of files, number of scopies, number of endoscopies, number of procedures. Then the head decided that this is not healthy. They sat down together and they distributed the departments. So one was hepatology, one was interventional gastroenterology, one was colon or whatever. They decided that they do group practice. So they divided those organs. They protected their leave. They still got a good salary. They were able to go on leave. They were able to grow. And they had separate money for research. So it's all a matter of having that shared vision, so that their boss had that vision. And because of that, there was no competition. Because I think finally competition kills. You know, I have to earn better than him. I have to have more scopies than him. I have to have more credit than him. So that is what kills the team. Vandana says, often service commitments rules out individual interests, and this can lead to dissatisfaction, but service has to be done, so everyone should chip in.
Anybody else wants to say anything?
Anjali madam is here for some time, so Anjali madam wants to say something.
Hi guys. Excuse me. I'm on. I'm listening, but I'm in OT, so I can't really participate.
Bye bye. Take care.
Bye.
Okay. Again, she should go home a little bit.
Yeah. But she's on call today. So
is Dr. Sohan still there? Anything further?
No, ma'am. I think we have covered many things. So. And also we are running out of time, so it's 7:30 now.
Perfect.
We can wrap up the session.
Okay.
So thank you, Anjum. That was a very great discussion.
Thank you.
Wonderful. We need topics like these once in a while, so that it refreshes us.
I know it did, but I don't know how much the postgraduates actually took home. And think, you know, so
challenging.
There were very less postgraduates. Mostly were the, I think, consultant and all. Well, so I think postgraduate are more interested in the
clinical stuff.
Pheochromocytoma of the 18th.
I think actually quite a few people have logged in.
Okay.
And I'll keep that in mind. Next topic will be soft skills. Okay. Chalo,
thank you, Anjum.
Bye. Bye. Good night. See you. Thank you, Vibha. Thank you, Sohan. Thank you, Dr.
Kalpana. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Shreesi. Thank you, ma'am.